Dino, you've been following the situation very closely. We've got the 10-year yields on the Lebanese international bond that spiked considerably from the 12-13% about a month ago to 17.35% in its last reading. You've been disappointed, though, with the policy response. What's gone wrong here?
There is no response. I think this is the problem. I think Zainab said it very accurately. They are paralyzed. And I think they're having a very difficult time accepting the reality that faces them. And so, you know, in an environment like this, which is very tense, which requires drastic action, you have a government that's unable to be formed, a president that's unable to move, you have a political parties that are not being able to face reality, almost schizophrenic. And so this creates an environment that gives the market very little confidence that Lebanon can really manage this crisis. And so that's why you see, as you correctly mentioned, bond prices and CDS levels basically pricing in a default in the next few months. And, you know, they are probably, you know, fairly accurate. We were on your show and, you know, talking about this in January, that this political construct is unlikely to be able to deal with the very serious structural reform that needs to take place. And the events of the past few weeks, if anything, kind of confirms that view.
Dino, it's lovely to see you again, of course. I was wondering, from the investor perspective, what would be top of your list for structural reforms in Lebanon? What would you like to see first?
I mean, if I had a wish list or a Christmas card, I mean, I would say the first thing they need to do is actually form a government. But the government needs to be formed first, I think, on the one hand, to tackle really public sector reform. You have electricity, which is a major drag on the deficit. And now you actually have the banking system. And this is the really interesting bit, is that, you know, so far, the government, the banks, and Hezbollah have essentially been, you know, they've had like an alignment of interests and they have been really running the country. And I think what this revolution has done is I think it's beginning to now, it's going to move these different stakeholders away from each other. And I think as this progresses, you're going to find that these stakeholders adopt different positions and they become much more confrontational. And, you know, I don't think that we are going to continue to see the banks cooperating with the government and the government cooperating with Hezbollah and all of these parties being able to meet the demands of the people. So this is a very delicate situation that is not going, that's not going in the right way.
Clearly for you, it's a wait and see on any Lebanese assets at the moment. How does it compare, though, to the rest of the region and the Gulf in particular? What do you like in terms of bond spreads?
So in general, the GCC is a very different animal. I mean, this is a high quality region. You know, oil prices are fairly constructive. They are pushing through very impressive structural reform agendas. They're opening up their markets. We're on the verge of seeing Aramco's IPO. I mean, there's a lot of very positive news that is taking place. So, I mean, I would look at that as an environment that is actually, very defensive. And today, I think risk is very top of mind. People are concerned about, you know, global growth. They're concerned about trade tensions. They're concerned about a number of issues. And I feel that, you know, in that environment, emerging markets in general will do well. And within emerging markets, I think the GCC is very well placed. Lebanon or many of the other, I think, geopolitical risks in the region, while very serious, tend to have very limited impact on the rest of the market. And so, Lebanon, I agree with you, is not going to be a trade that we would consider in the short term, at least until we see, you know, some institutional developments. Whereas the rest of the region, we think, is a very attractive destination, especially in an environment where risk is very top of mind.
Dino, I just want to go back to Lebanon on that point. Is a debt restructuring an inevitability at this point?
I think so. We said in January that Lebanon should pursue a voluntary debt restructuring, to be able to create some space, some fiscal space to be able to carry through these very urgent structural reforms. And I think now time is passing by, and if they cannot move forward, I think the concept of a voluntary restructuring starts diminishing and it becomes a very, hard landing or a collapse. And this is what's at stake. And I'm honestly amazed that, you know, the paralysis that has gripped this political class is not helping the situation at all. I mean, they are literally losing control day by day. You know, you have a central bank government that's lost control of the pound. It's trading in the black market. You have capital controls that are in place, but they don't push through any sort of regulations around it. This is going to create even more, you know, more tension. And the system appears broken and the credibility is gone and, you know, they can't seem to move. So, yeah, Lebanon is not in, in a good place, and we need to see some decisive action and I think some engagement with multilateral agencies or with donor countries to be able to move forward.